the godfather of cryptocurrency,
the man who invented DigiCash,
David Chaum, ladies and gentlemen.
To see so many young people interested in cryptography, and the whole world is starting to realize the power of this technology.
This is a very exciting time.
We have now a main chance to take the energy of blockchain forward to a consumer product at a global scale. So now you create your own keys with your own equipment. You control exclusively access to your own information.
As you know, I've been an advocate of digital rights, digital sovereignty, and empowering individuals in the information age for many years.
Either we're going to be moving towards a world in which people are data subjects, or alternatively, people have control over their own information.
Privacy is intimately tied to human potential, and that it's an extraordinarily important aspect of democracy.
How should we structure the network to make it effective so that it can really grow and attract all the kinds of services and users that it will need so that it can predominate?
There still was not a strictly digital-only currency until the DigiCash company was started by David Chaum in 1990.
So far, we have excellent store of value systems, but we haven't really reached the global consumer payment system.
I think we can do better, so I've got a new vision.
I've been traveling around the world giving keynotes.
We come with blockchain inside, a fundamental part of consumer life. It's an extraordinarily powerful enabler for consumers to create their own informational world. And so it's an extraordinary opportunity for society to kind of reinvent itself. Consumers have demonstrated globally that they really want is messaging integrated with payments, with real privacy, not just end-to-end encryption of message content, but actually protecting the social graph, the metadata, who talks to who, pays who, and when.
So we'd like to make something that is like WeChat, but with blockchain inside.
And in order to achieve that, there are really four fundamental requirements.
It has the kind of performance that consumers have come to expect, or more or less demand. 10 seconds from initiation of payment to the final consummation of payment, from sending a message until one is received.
Otherwise, you're asking people to accept something that's much worse than what they already have and what they expect. The next thing is that most people, of course, don't want all of their payments history transparently, immutably on the blockchain. So we need a better type of privacy than current messaging systems, even the privacy-oriented ones.
An infrastructure that will allow people to have a protected space where they can freely communicate and also pay for information without any fear,
then that will, of course, mean that we have to be able to provide these sorts of transactions at consumer scale. Now, there's a fourth requirement. Many countries don't really relish the idea of other countries coming in and controlling their own consumer payment systems and messaging systems.
What actually is wanted is a level playing field for the new kinds of financial services that emerging countries would love to offer to their citizens, but they don't want a kind of economic imperialism.
The types of public key signatures that are used today are the basis for payment security, and blockchain probably aren't something that are secure against attack by a nation state.
There's a long history of nations trying to destroy the consumer payment system of other nations during war.
The kind of security that is needed is something that is not really been achieved to date. It has to be based
on a quantum-resistant cryptography.
What we've been able to do is actually meet these requirements completely, and that is because of two fundamental breakthroughs in cryptography that took me quite a lot of effort.
The way our blockchain works is a little bit different from others in that we have a team of nodes that are producing each block instead of a single node. And so when a team is scheduled to operate the network and produce a block, it has already done a lot of work in advance to prepare for this real-time operation so it can very rapidly process the messages through.
And the set of nodes is chosen randomly and uniformly and independently and unmanipulatably by a distributed random algorithm. And I will show you the underlying mechanism for that now here in a kind of cartoon analogy.
Suppose Alice wants to send a message to Bob, but she doesn't want anyone to know that the two of them are communicating. Message content can easily be protected by so-called end-to-end encryption, but this does not protect the information about who's talking to whom and when, the metadata, which is increasingly recognized as far more revealing and more challenging to protect. Each member of a team of nodes, in order to protect the metadata, successively shuffles the batch of encrypted messages using its container of secretly arranged tubes and sending the messages without delay through to the next team member. Even just a single node can keep senders from being linked to recipients. Alice also gets a receipt informing her confidentially that her message was provided to Bob. Team members then destroy their secret pattern of tubes, making way for a new team ready for a new batch. Earlier, each node is chosen independently as a kind of random secret key, which input tube to connect to which output tube. Elixir's breakthrough over the type of messaging I open sourced in the 80s is a way that enables almost all the work to be done well in advance, yielding the only known way to provide real-time metadata protection smartphone to smartphone. Leap can also pay Yumi by sending what appears to be an ordinary message, but that actually contains numbers that serve like metal coins and paper money. Called such denominated unforgeable numbers, digital cash, first issued by DigiCash in the 90s. Elixir's breakthrough improvement on the original digital cash now makes it fully distributed and quantum resistant. Elixir thus is able to uniquely provide a new ultimate metadata level protection of confidentiality in all your online communications and payments. For the first time, giving you a protected sphere protecting your digital world today and your digital future.
And this is the trend globally. We have WhatsApp and Venmo or WeChat. All these systems are trying to integrate payments and messaging. We do it with a metadata level of protection. We hide the social graph. No one can see who you're talking to and when. Of course, we have blockchain inside, which strengthens the messaging.
We have it running on smartphones, Android and iOS. When you run this on a smartphone, it doesn't use any more data plan. It doesn't use any more battery power because there's very little public key operations. And it doesn't make you wait longer. So it's what consumers want, but with blockchain inside. You amp up the privacy in messaging beyond anything that's available today, you give adequate privacy in payments, and you get the blockchain records. We've been running it for several months in several cloud servers. You know, if you can go to a merchant and say, here, accept these payments, you don't have to give 2.5% or 5% to a bank, just accept these payments. Are they gonna say no? We've seen consumers migrate from less secure messaging systems to ones that provide end-to-end encryption. Will we see them migrate to ones that provide both metadata protection and this immutability and recordation? I hope so.
Well, once the blockchain is really a mainstream consumer product, then I don't think it will face any more regulatory obstacles, and I think it will become a favored platform for consumers and a place where dApps can flourish. And dApps can be an extraordinarily powerful new kind of thing that can interface to all sorts of information in a secure manner, and their flexibility and potential is kind of unlimited and hard to really foresee.
We do have a way to allow a dApp to run off-chain, so we don't have the performance issues like some other well-known chains have with running smart contracts and so on. We run them completely off-chain, and they get all the benefits of running on-chain without actually slowing the main chain down at all.
You can take basically any dApp or smart contract and divide it into two parts. One is the part that controls the messaging and the payments, and the other part is the rest, the business logic of it. So we have a way for the Elixir chain to actually allow multi-sig control of all sending and receiving of messages and making and receiving of payments to a multi-party computation that runs off-chain.
And this provides an ideal platform for dApps.
It's quite hard to imagine enormous flexibility in all kinds of potential new uses and new structures in the informational world. So new kinds of organizations, new kinds of financial services, new kinds of time-saving and protective measures, and all kinds of things that people might make just for their own use or used by very small communities, to things that might become huge memes and widespread applications. It's at a very exciting moment. We're at the beginning of the dApp revolution.
We'll join our community and work with us to take blockchain mainstream.
Thank you very much again, Dr. Yeah.